April's forest fire down there. Amen. Living trees have been set on fire. Living bushes have been set on fire for the Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. In light of things that's been happening on this week, of course, we know that the church knows what was going on in regards to our sister Jacinta, you know, and how the enemy tried to attack her. We never glorify that, but out of that, God gave the victory. Amen.
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 That's what, when you serve a victorious God, you're going to get the power from that, and it is victory. No matter what the circumstance is that you have, but the victory, and how the church mobilized and fortified her in the midst, in her time of need. You know, the clarion call went out, the trumpet was sound that look after our sister. Look after our sister. So everyone showed up, and it was just a wonderful experience in spite of the situation, because the spirit of unity and love was in place and very active. And intercession went forth in a mighty way in regards to her and her family. You know, it's something about when a loved one is away, they can trust, you know, those that are around to support their children. Amen? Because the bishop and first lady poured so much into us, whether it be gifting, laying on hands, and also doing the training. And it's one of the things that he had taught us very much to say, stay the course. Everyone say, stay the course.
Stay the course.
No matter what it looks like.
No matter what it looks like.
Stay the course.
Stay the course.
See, when the word said, God has no pleasure in those who draw back. When you put your hand to the plow, you got to keep moving forward. And naturally, when you plow through things, it will take your strength as well as the thing's strength that's pulling the plow. Amen.
Amen.
That's a twofold thing. You work together. Amen.
Amen.
So I want to go right to the word, and God has given me this word. I said, Lord, I knew what was going on, and he told me how to position myself in the midst of what was going on, and he gave me instructions how to move in the midst of what's going on. So yesterday, around about 12 o'clock, I was able to get some type of rest. You know, I fell asleep in the front room church just listening to him, and I said, Lord, what is it that you want me to do? And some of you may be saying, well, how can you talk to the Lord like that? Because it says in the Bible, you must inquire of the Lord what you should do. You know, take that what, when, and how. You know, we use it in the English, you know, the what, when, and how, in order to answer questions about what we're reading. But that what, when, and how also applies when you're seeking God. Amen?
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 So it was a stillness, no word, a stillness. And I waited upon the Lord. He said, wait. So in the wee hours of the morning, he spoke one word. Amen?
Amen.
That one word he spoke to me was called boldness. And I began to meditate on that word, boldness. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Everyone says boldness.
Boldness.
Come on, let's get loud, let's get bold with it. Let everyone say boldness.
Boldness.
Amen. Now, Maurice, I want you to read some scriptures set up for me. And as we go forward in this, I want you to set some Proverbs 28:1. Amen. Let the church say amen. Again, let us say boldness.
Boldness.
Amen. Thank God for musicians coming in. And we're going to keep moving right along. Amen.
Amen.
They can play under me as we go in the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So, let's turn now to Proverbs 28:1. You may look on the screen. And it says, the wicked flee when no man pursueth. The first thing he said, the wicked flees when no man pursues, but the righteous are bold as a lion. And I meditate, I begin to meditate on that and say, Lord, you said the wicked flees when no man pursues. So the wicked, what caused him to flee? And No man pursued them. Fear. That's what he told me. He said, fear will drive the wicked, but not the righteous. They are bold as a lion because their trust is in me, said the Lord Almighty. Let me say it again for you. Fear will drive the wicked, but not the righteous. They are bold as a lion because their trust is in me, says the Lord. I said, my goodness, my Father, my God. Fear will cause the wicked to flee.
Glory.
Now, what type of fear are we talking about? You got the natural fear of circumstances. Yes, if we get caught, then we're going to be punished or we're going to be put to death. That natural fear will cause them to flee. But there's a fear of the natural. It is a supernatural fear of God will cause them to flee. Boldness, a willingness to take risks take the necessary risk in faith to accomplish that assignment. Amen?
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Now the word that I want to send you for boldness is called parousia, or parousia, which means confidence, fearlessness. And it means free and fearless confidence, cheerful boldness, assurance. That means that when you have a boldness, that you have assurance that God and all of heaven is backing you up. All of heaven is backing you up when you're bold for Christ.
Amen.
But when you draw back from the things that God has called you to, not only cause God to have a displeasure in his soul in regards to you. Everyone say boldness.
Boldness.
Say it again, say boldness.
Boldness.
Thank you. You're going to do a little move on this one. You're going to punch this train and keep moving. Amen.
Amen.
I don't worry about the size. I don't worry about who's behind me.
Lord.
The Holy Ghost is watching his word. He watched over his word to perform. Say, for example, come here, Thomas. For example. You come up here. You're going to speak to me. Always keep in mind who's watching his word to perform. He represents God. I'm the preacher. I don't care if it's one or a thousand in here. He's watching that word. Amen? Because that word is going to perform, he's going to do what? He's going to perform the word that's been declared from the altar. He's going to perform the word that he has spoken from his heavenly sanctuary. He's going to perform the word because number one, he gave it to him. I'm responsible to release this word in his right now only because he gave it to me. Yeah. And if I draw back and give him this word, give you all this word, he has no pleasure in his soul. Amen. Brother Tucker, ladies and gentlemen. Everyone say goals. Again, I recap. Proverbs, let's put that on the screen. Proverbs 28:1. The wicked flee when no man pursues, but the righteous are bold as a lion. The topic is boldness. Subtopic, what does your boldness look like? And who's standing next to it? Everyone say, what does your boldness look like? And who's standing next to you? Now in the world it goes like this. Everyone say, you are what you eat.
You are what you eat.
You are what you drink.
You are what you drink.
And you represent the atmosphere that you are in. Amen?
Amen.
You are what you eat. You are what you drink. And you represent the atmosphere that you entertain. Meaning, whatever I put inside this body, my body will respond to it. Whether I drink, eat, or in an atmosphere where it's not conducive for this body. Like you go to, for example, if you're in an atmosphere where a lot of people smoke, your body will smell like what?
Cigarettes.
Your clothes will smell like what?
Cigarettes.
Now, what type of smoke? Like, all type of smoke out there. I don't want to say that, but they got all type of smoke. You can tell what type of atmosphere a person has been just by their clothes. Amen?
Amen.
So you are what you eat, drink, and the atmosphere that you entertain. But when you entertain God, when you're in his presence, you're going to have an aroma of his presence. When you drink God, your body's going to be strong because, number one, you're ingesting God. When you eat God, your body's going to be what? Strengthened because, number one, you eat God. Now, what I mean by this, let's go to Acts 4:13 and 14. Amen.
Amen.
We'll get to the punchline, but right now I want to give you a baseline right now. At one time they asked for chapter 13 and 14. Boldness is a necessary ingredient to do the acts of God. Amen? Boldness is a necessary ingredient to get the faith, your faith moving with God. Don't worry about it. Just keep on moving. Amen? Everybody got that?
Amen.
Amen? Now, when they saw us turn to Acts, can we get a reader, please? Acts, Sister Donna, to read for me, please. Amen. You can take this Bible, Sister Donna, to read. My Lord, amen. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Give her a call this microphone, too. Amen. Read from Acts 4, verse 13 and 14.
But the multitude of the city was divided.
I'm sorry, sir. Acts 4, verse 13 and 14. We're talking about boldness on this morning. Whatever you practice, whatever you give yourself over to, that's what you're going to be bold in. Whatever your discipline may be, and you're sure of your discipline, that's what you're going to be bold in. Just give her the microphone, please. Amen. Now this is happening. This is happening right when you get back up. This is happening right when the man at the gate, beautiful, was saying alms. He was begging for money, and Peter and John said, "Silver and gold we have none, but such as I have, we give it unto thee." And such as I have given unto thee. And they grabbed him, and he yanked him up. And immediately as he was being yanked up, strength came to his leg bone, ankle bone, his hip bone. And he began to leap and shout in the midst of the congregation during the time of prayer. And he created such a ruckus and a noise that the rulers at that time of the courts of the priesthood had called them forth. And now Peter, it was like, before these rulers, the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the court. Now, we read as they go. Let's pick it up in verse 13. You may read now, please.
Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John.
Stop right there. Your boldness has a look. When they saw the boldness of Peter and John, go ahead.
And perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men.
Go ahead.
They marveled, and they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus.
14.
And beholding the man which was healed standing with them, they could say nothing against him.
Stop right there. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, boldness is a noun. Boldness is a verb. Boldness is a prosperity. It's a prosperity. Your prosperity is in your bowls. Say it with me. My prosperity is in my bowls.
My prosperity is in my bowls.
If you don't rise, kill, and eat, you won't have anything to eat. But if you rise in God, become bold in God, become bold in the things that He has assigned you to, sins to stop you. But when you already strong in the power of His might, you can rise above that. In other words, you can have a miracle and a testimony on your side that the enemy cannot say anything about. But this is the ingredient that the church is missing. When we first got saved, there was a boldness. We began to tell everybody about the goodness of Jesus. We began to tell everybody how we got the rest from our soul, because no longer are we at war with Jesus. Now that we have the peace of Jesus on the inside, then what happened to the bones? The curse of this world began to cycle away your boldness, weaken your boldness. What people begin to say, your irritate that is negative begin to weaken your boldness. Now your boldness begins to hide, like we say in the scripture. Why don't you put your candle on the table when your candle should be upon the table so that the light can draw many men? But all the time, because of the church world, because of church politics, because of prayer in this world, because of our own flesh, or because of our own being, that we put our boldness away and we all begin to do something else. We prefer our boldness to do something else.
Amen.
We take our boldness qualities in the world and say, I want this and I want that. Or you may say you're covered in this, you may cover someone else's woman, car, houses, or lifestyle, and you all get your boldness for the wrong things when it should be placed in the right vein. That boldness be heard, but thus said God.
Lord.
It even said in the scripture, come boldly before the throne of grace that you may obtain mercy. But many of our Christian saints, brothers and sisters, come weep before the throne of mercy. You can't get anything done looking pitiful. But that's what the body looks like right now. We've gotten to a place, so the place that many of us have become looking pitiful. Oh, bless me. Jesus said, but you can bless me, give me some crumbs. He said, why are you asking for some crumbs? You can have everything I have. You're my child. This is like you going home and going to your refrigerator and say, Mama, can I give me some water? And she said, hey, you my child. And you come back and say, Mama, can I give me some bread? That's how we look when we don't approach the throne of grace boldly. And sometimes the mother say, nah, I don't need nothing in there. Close my refrigerator, because I'm tired of you coming to me pitifully. When you got the rights to everything in this house, but you want to ask me like you're a stranger in your own house. Now you want something? No. Shut the door. Then you're going to turn around. Who's God? Man of God. Man of the man of God. Man of yourself. Man of the word. Then you're going to turn your back to the enemy who's already stupid and dumb and bold anyway. He's retarded. Because when you tell him to stop, he's going to come back to you with the ball. You want to try again? You going to say to get away? You want to try again? That's what the word said. Resist the devil and he will flee. But there's a strength in resisting. You know what resisting means? When somebody try to grab you, you snatch back. And then actually saying, get off me. You being bold. You know, if someone come after you, say you begin to scream, and that boldness come out, he will flee. Well, then it's, don't devil stop. Don't leave me alone. Don't leave me alone. He think you're playing with him. Number one, you have no authority in your action. But when you have authority, show authority in your action, you snatch back, you be able to stop. He'll back down. Oh, we're not to sell wolf tickets when y'all in the world, am I right?
Amen.
Am I right?
Amen.
Yeah. Most people can't even fight, but they act like they can fight. So just because they act like they can fight, the fight is a burden. Use all kind of hands, just like women use all kind of hands, just and rubs with all kind of postures, you know what I'm saying? Get that posture. Neck swell, shoulder swell, voice giggles, and that means that you have some type of authority about yourself, and they'll back away from you because you have some type of authority personified. But there are those who are going to test your authority, and if you don't have authority, you're going to turn and run.
Amen.
So it is in the natural, so it is in the spiritual realm. We walk around like we have authority, but when it really comes to rubber meet the road, we're not spending time in prayer. We're not spending time in fellowship. We're not spending time in worship. We're not spending time in praise. We're not spending time in the fellowship of the unity of the church. We're not spending time, but when the rubber hit the road and the enemy began to challenge you like ever before, then what are you going to stand on? How are you going to stand? How are you going to be vigilant in the midst of war? How are you going to be vigilant in the midst of hard times? Like I said, when the times are tough, tough people stand. The tough people don't. Just think, if our military was weak and feeble and someone comes to possess the land, how are we going to get our land back? When you give yourself to discipline, and the body of Christ always like to go to King David, because King David was a warring person. Am I right?
Amen.
But before King David, there was another warrior. We're going to get to that warrior in just a few minutes. But boldness is when you come from in his presence. Now listen, I'm going to say this to you, just say this to me. When you show a lack of confidence, you know what that means? We know that you haven't studied. You know that you haven't studied, show yourself approved. It can mean that too. But I'm talking to the other side. A lack of confidence or being shy means that you're being selfish. The root of a lack of confidence is selfishness. Because you're being so selfish that you don't want to practice your discipline. You don't want to give yourself over to reading. Take this to the musicians. They weren't selfish in regards to practicing discipline in regards to music. So when they come out, they can be bold with their music because they gave themselves over to them. They're confident because of their music. Everyone say confidence.
Confidence.
If you want confidence, you've got to go through the trials of failure in the midst of discipline. The disciples hit a level of confidence and boldness because they failed and went through failures in the midst of Jesus. Jesus recommended them several times again. He said, where is your faith? When he told them, you feed them. When he walked upon the water, they were fearful. And Peter showed another confidence and said, Lord, if it's you, bid me to come. And he had the confidence to step out that water and walk on the water because the one, he had the boldness to ask him to bid me to come. But many of the body of Christ don't ask God to bid me to come. Want to sit back and watch someone else waiting for them because we've been conditioned all the time as a society to watch others win for us. We watch sports all the time. You see 24 men on the field playing football, and you can be more than that on the football field, but guess what? We're satisfied with just watching the 24 play ball. They're my heroes. That's how we've been conditioned. The enemy is programming your mind and don't even know. But God has come to give you a new mind on the day. You spend time with him. You're a part of him. He'll direct your paths. He said in the word, the footsteps of a righteous man is ordered by the Lord. How can you get your order if you don't spend time with him? How can you understand and trust in his word if you don't spend time with him? And when God said, move to the left, he said, oh, did you say move to the left? He said, you take two steps to the left. You take two steps to the left and a passing car round speed right by. Ooh, thank you, Lord. So now you got to go through the elementary process of teaching you how to trust him through circumstances, through trial and error. But you don't have to go through trial and error. All you have to do is spend time in his presence, and he begins to order your footsteps, and you begin to trust in his word. And he says, don't go this way today. Take it this way now. And you take that way, and then all of a sudden you hear about the news what happened the way that you know it would take it. But when you don't inquire of God, you don't spend time with him, and then guess what? You begin to get fearful in his presence. And that's a normal thing to do when you don't spend time in his presence. When you don't know what else of God comes from, you're going to shake and tremble. You're going to run because you ain't spent given his word. He has not left us in the dark. Everyone say, he has not left us in the dark. To think otherwise is to lie. Let me see the Bible. Let me see the Bible. Our children need to know. Once upon a time, Mother Daisy, you say, once upon a time, we came up, we went to Sunday Bible school, vacation Bible school, Sunday school. We learned how to read on a child level. God introduced himself on a child level through the teachers. But nowadays, everybody wants to be on the pool instead of teaching. But see, when I start up, I'd rather be in the back teaching versus the pulpit. Because I can see the fruit in a child begin to flourish and grow. And when they become a young adult, a teenager, you see the fruit begin to grow even steadily. But nowadays, we step over our children. We give our children over to what? Laptops, tablets, TV, the internet. Amen? They go over, tap on the phone, find out superpowers on YouTube, which is all those things are good, don't get me wrong, but all those things have a place. But all those things cannot take the place of this living world.
Lord.
All these things that we got, these conveniences and technology, cannot take the place of this living word. We've been designed to walk in this word, to talk with this word, and to hear this word speak back to us. Amen? Well, give me some backdrop right quick. This past Sunday, when I wasn't here, my wife and I, we went to Memphis to go see Jackson State versus Tennessee State. I saw a whole level of faith. See, the world got a level of faith, whether it comes rain, snow, sleet, or shine, they're going to be out there in the rain to watch the game. It was raining cats and dogs down there, and some pigs and elephants down there. But the people out there in the rain with no umbrellas. No umbrellas. Having a good time. Hairdos, outfits, soaked and wet. Having a good time. Looking to see a game. I said, look what kind of faith is down here versus the faith that's in St. Louis. Let it rain in St. Louis. People be running for cover. But the thing I'm getting at, they were bold enough, the elements could not drive them away. Celebrate the natural occasion. But how much more can we do in the spiritual realm? But when a little wind blows our way, a little wind trouble blows our way, you want to go hide behind the man of God. But the man of God says, you pray, you teach, you teach, you fall down the enemy, you kill the enemy, you pull it down. But all of a sudden, we want to be like the wind. Of God. commit suicide and said, yeah, then I'm going to be with the Lord. God said, I got something for you. You think you're about to die, but I'm showing you my mercy. I'm going to put you in the belly of the whale. And let you get a taste of what death is like, or what hell is like. Do you want to go there? Took Jonah 3 days. He prayed. I'll go for 3 days. When he got in the belly of the whale, he made a 3 day journey in 1 day. See, the thing is that we become bold in sin consciousness, but not bold in God consciousness. But now there's a pivot when it's starting to shift from being sin conscious as a body, but become more God conscious as a body. Who are you to determine what God's going to do in his sovereignty with someone else? When he told you, if you get this assignment done, then I have the next assignment for you. But until you finish this time, you will go around this mountain of your life time and time again, time and time again, time and time again. All you have to do is complete one assignment. And prosperity is right behind it. Your prosperity is in the midst of war. Your prosperity is in the midst of the obedience of getting things done. Because you have to war with yourself in order to get things done. You know, the most disciplined and rich people in the world, they got to do this. Regardless, what goes on around that world, they make sure at the end of the day that they check out everything they're supposed to check out regardless of the to-do list. But black, lazy people, white, lazy people, all races that are lazy people, they don't want to ever check anything out. Well, God's going to give it to me. I believe God. Years pass by. Don't you say, I believe God, and they're glad. Well, thanks, God. But all you have to do is be bold in your faith. Say bold faith.
Bold
faith. Favors. You want faith with God? Get bold faith. My children saw me for the operation. I mean, we went there real quick. It was raining. We didn't have any tickets. We drove 4 hours. And the tickets I was supposed to get, the person who had my tickets were in the office that was like guarded by police officers and ticket tellers, and it was in the VIP section. And I went up there to get my ticket because what happened is that in that particular arena at the Liberty Bowl, there's no cell phones, towers. You can't even call the person right next to you. It's just a dead zone. So I'm like, I'm in the midst of a dead zone. It's pouring down rain. I got my family here, no tickets, and we're trying to get to the game. And I'm like, what can we do? And the Holy Ghost said, walk right through the people. And as I began to walk right through those people, my wife began to pray, not knowing to my mind. She was praying. So as I walked through the people, no one stopped asking for the ticket anything because why? I walked with both.
All right.
Walk right through. Right through the police officers. They didn't say anything to me. Right through the doors. They didn't say anything to me. Right through the other people that's working in the facility in VIP, they didn't say anything to them. Because the backdrop of it is that you have to have a ticket to turn. Then you have to have a wristband on your arm to let you know that you're VIP. I walked right through it. And I went through that with confidence and both.
I said, where's so-and-so?
She asked my tickets. And she said, oh, okay. She kind of laughed. She said, hell. Everything's so phony. Now we're walking, I'm walking off the tickets. But guess what? Because of the boldness, favor is there for the bold. Because of the boldness, I was walking up. The young man, the older man is over everything in VIP. He said, are you VIP? I said, yes, I am. Now the person that had my ticket looked at me, I looked at him, I said, yes, I am. He said, is he with you? She said, yes, he is. At least family. But he said that he's VIP. And he gave me the purple band around my arm. I took 3 other purple bands out to my family. I said, come on, we're going straight to the room. Now, it's probably 55,000 black people in this building, the stadium. And he said, listen, go to this room here or that room there. That's where the food is. I said, well, all right. Am I right?
Amen.
Now, we go right there. Didn't make me anything. We drove 4 hours in the rain. Time and everything out there was raining. All the whole time was going down, like I said, past the all rats and everything else. In the rain. I said, these people got that kind of faith. I quiet and nervous in their room. My wife, my daughter, and my grandson saw. And the head man, I didn't know to my knowledge, the head man is over the whole thing, was watching the door. See, just like you. Watching the door, come to the door, and he had the stern look at. And I come to my, I had the stern, I looked at him real stern. Well, I looked at him like this, and you looked at me like this. I said, 1 million after next million now. I looked at him like, I got more money than you, and you don't even know. And I got more money than you, so I walk in like this. I walk in bold. He said, where are you from? I'm from D.C. He said, you from D.C.? They from D.C. too. What's up? I said, hey, I ain't going to have nothing. Because let me tell you something. Faith does not give you every step. But if you listen to God, he'll give you the steps because you know the end from what? The beginning. You just see the beginning. Now, before we left there, the Lord told me to put on these D.C. shirts. You know, they were having on the 4th Sunday. The museum shirt, the African American Museum in D.C. Everybody had their shirts on. Everybody had their hats on. And we rode. I walked up there and he saw this shirt. He saw my wife's shirt. He saw my daughter's shirt. He said, okay. He said, what part of D.C. are you from? I said, Sydney. Sydney. Oh, I said, oh, my wife. You know, he said, that's what I'm telling you. This is a level of faith. Paul said, I have become all things to all men that I may save some. You hear me? Bones. I had to be bold in her. I couldn't show no weakness, no pitifulness, and confidence amidst all those millionaires. Because the word of the Lord was coming through my mouth to get to this man's heart because this man had a problem. The woman, the wife had a problem. We was on the side and we didn't even know about it. Now these millionaires, they got problems. Just like you and me. But God is merciful and so loving and kind that I began to talk to him and warm him up, burn him up, got him on. He began to talk money and finances. And then I said, oh yeah, I began to shoot back and forth because God was giving me quickening what to say, how to say, how to say, because God is wanting to get to his pride. All the millionaires in there. My wife would take me, when they first got there, everybody's in the corner like this. Back in the corner like this. All right, my wife, my daughter, my grandson, and back happened like this. I said, uh-uh, that was just a meeting. He said, they look at me like, who are you? This must be. Everybody come through, I know. I said, that was just a meeting. He told me, get chicken, make it everything money, right? Now, he eat. And the woman began to talk to my wife. And the man began to talk to me about situations and circumstances. God gave me quick understanding. Everybody said, quick understanding. When you walk in faith and boldness, he will give you a quick understanding of your atmospheres, a quick understanding of the spirits in the room, a quick understanding of the situation, problem, and solution. Because, guess what? A quick understanding is very useful so that he may be glorified. And he began to warm up to me. Now, everybody that came to that door, I'm going to hear what you he said, just like it looked like you're real stern, like a heavy eye and everything. Like, yeah, okay, no. He came and said, you see that man right there? He's one of our major contributors, multimillionaire. The ROTC came in. See, ROTC, he's the head of ROTC. He's a major contributor. He's a major contributor. Now, he's talking like a contributor. Now, I had to have my voice like that, too. So we talking back and forth, they're contributors. You know? So he said, he's a major contributor. I said, oh, well, yeah, wow, okay. So now we're talking. Now, here comes another guy, another major contributor, come talk. Now, he come in and shake his hand and leave right back out. I'm like, oh, my boy, brother. You got a problem. And I don't know what your problem is, but God knows what your problem is. I'm on the side. Say, boldness begets your faith. Especially when you're in faith. So now I got the faith of this man right here, we're talking. All of a sudden, it comes to this issue that, hey, listen, he put in a proposal for this contract they're doing in New Jersey. He's from New Jersey. He said, I got a contract from New Jersey, but the governor only gave me $800. I'm trying to work with what I'm working with. He said, you only got $800 million. I'm saying, so I said, so what do you need, $3.2 billion? He said, no, actually, I need $13 billion. And I got, I dollars. It's a trifecta that is through the state, city, and the federal government. The federal government only gave me $800 million. I had to buy me 200 trucks, and I had to get drivers who keep them trucks going around 24 hours a day in order to keep this project going. I only got $800 million. I need $13 billion. I'm saying, okay, well, now the Lord gave me a quick understanding. I said, well, they have, what should they do? They're packing in fresh waters from northern part of New York State down to Manhattan, down to New Jersey. They're building a fresh water pipeline that's like a mile and a half deeper than the subway line. I said, well, the Lord said, well, they extended Manhattan, right? He said, yes, they're extending Manhattan. I said, where are they getting the dirt from? He said, I said, they're getting it from the new fresh water pipeline that's coming from northern New York down to the city. And it's a project that they're paying for. I said, you know how much money real estate is worth in Manhattan? He said, yes, it's very expensive. I said, well, this is your aim. He said, well, you take your 200 dump trucks and say, I want to extend what the fresh water pipeline is doing and extend Manhattan, which is going to increase the reality, which is going to increase the realtor property. And he said, you know what? I'm going to look into that. Black men have the black problem, not the solution for the man of God. By that time, took the wife and daughter to him. He's real warm by the end. He said, oh, yeah, so, this man, give it to him. And he gave his seat to my grandson. He said, no, you should not. Then I had another man that comes up and said, well, he had a proxy. He said, I said, I'm leaving a proxy around here. This thing's up here. You want to do the reverse? He said, my goodness. Now, as I begin to tell him, I say, boldness, I say, discipline yields confidence. Confidence yields self-esteem. You gave yourself to a discipline. You have a certain level of confidence, and you have a certain level of self-esteem. I say, this is what I'm teaching in St. Louis. I touch down in St. Louis. I teach the young men this in St. Louis. I'm saying, Lord, went to my brother and said, hey, you know what I'm talking about? Now, I'm in the Testament. Am I right? And the moment I said that, the few guys I know, we had like about 30 people from St. Louis that worked there, two of the guys came around the corner, bam, boom, and the air got real thick again, boom, who are you? He was saying, he said, hey, because they don't get right in my ear by that time, in the private quarters. He said, hey, I said, what's up, man? All right, I said, and these were the young men right here. I said, this is what I trained since he was a little baby. Now he's the youngest supervisor in the VA in St. Louis. He's the youngest, this is my mentor. The youngest supervisor in the VA hospital. He said, this is my mentor. And this other one I trained right here, so. And he said, Ed, I talked to him yesterday. He said, Ed, when we first walked in there, nobody wanted to say anything to him. But when I left there, they hugging me, giving all kinds of, I said, because fame is from the board. And then faith. When I got there, working with the Lord, giving this man his solution to his problem, in God, he gave me his card. Before he gave his card, he only gave the card to the important people. Now, we was leaving, my wife would tell you, everybody left. He said, well, what are you going to do? I said, well, I'll call the traffic company. I'm not going to fight the traffic either. I'm going to sit here and enjoy the occupancy of this place. We're going to eat, we're going to laugh, go somewhere, enjoy yourself. Long story short, when he left, here come the ROTC, here come the other people. They shook his hand and ran out, and they began to eat. I said, you can stay here and eat with me. He said, no, I'm not going to do that. Am I right? They saw a level of faith and boldness in God. Your boldness and faith in God will cause doors to open. The word said he make room for you. Your gift will make room for you. But what is the gift? The gift of boldness, the gift of faith, the gift of just being in His presence will make room for you. It will open doors and you'll be seated amongst kings. When you get amongst kings, you can act like a king. You won't act like a peasant. Because number one, you're above all of that. Because number one, you spend time with the King of Kings. Two homeless looking people.
I need $2 more. I need $3 more to get this piece. I need $2 more, $3 more to get this piece. I saw the money in his hand. And I said, what you getting? I said, well, tell you what, I'll take care of what you want to take care of. Just don't get it. I'm talking to him. Everybody ran back to their cars because they were homeless. They know people don't get money, go back to cars like they do. And I'm outside talking to him by the labor of the Spirit of God. I'm out there talking to him. He said, listen, I've been in the military. I finished my job and so on and so on. So. And he's drunk state. He said, I may be drunk into a fashion. I'm not a violent person. I've just been dealing with so and so. A veteran, a war veteran. And his other partner, who was real quiet, sitting back with his tattered clothes and hole right here, they just trying to get something to eat because the bus terminal was right across the street. Greyhound bus terminal, so they just in transit, going from one place to home or wherever they were going. They were just trying to get something to eat while the bus was in between the transit. So now I'm giving them the food, following God, and then all of a sudden, Lord, I'm about to turn away. I paid for myself what I'm supposed to pay for. He said, man, thank you. God bless you. I said, no, God bless you. I said, we army men. We take care of each other. We hold the land. We maintain the land. And so I walked back to the car. The Lord said, give me $10 more. I said, $10 more. So I'm calling $10 out, right? And that $10 out, while the door's open, I'm counting $10 out. He comes to the door. He's walking and says, sir, can I get something to drink? Can you need something to drink? I told him, I said, oh. The Lord said, give me this $10. So I got back in the car. You know, he said, pray for me. So I went there and I started praying for him. You know, tattered clothes, drunk state, all that kind of drunk state, all that kind of stuff. I said, man, I said, do you have Jesus? I said, let's pray the sinner's prayer that Jesus come to your heart. He began to pray. He said, yes, I have Jesus in my heart. Now, his other partner was more than quiet. He laid hands on me. The three of us began to pray and thank Jesus for this moment, this time, and all these kinds of, all these wonderful things in the midst of everything. So you just can't count on everybody. So then all of a sudden I said, okay, big brother, how are you all in me? Be blessed. He said, no, sir. Bless you and bless the God you serve. All the same. Favor is for the bold. Favor is for the bold. And especially when you're in God and God gives you instruction, you're going to come off the right path. Not what fury should come out of, but what he wants. Everybody say what he wants. See, the subtitle said, what does your boldness look like? And what's standing next to it? They couldn't say anything against Paul and John because guess what? The proof was in the pudding. Their boldness caused that man to rise in the name of Jesus Christ. And when it said he can conquer before them, they said it didn't say anything because the one, the miracle was standing right next to him. When you follow God, when you do what God said, then guess what? The miracle will be standing right.
You healing that is in the world. What you going to do when you spend time with him, you tap into the healing that is in you. Lay him out.
Then take care of the business.
An example of that, just want to use a word of sense inside the hall. David Madison, you don't want to make me mad. You don't want to like me when I'm mad. You tell them you don't want to get to praying. You don't like what I'm praying. You don't want to give me the worship. You don't like when I worship. Because when you worship and pray, you spend fellowship with him, then the God in you comes out. And the God in you begin to speak. And all the creation got to line up. The seen and the unseen. But it gives us sanity. The only thing that can hurt the heart, basically, is when they make you sleep. Slumber is your number one enemy. Insurmountable force, your regiment is your force. Whatever you give yourself to, that's the kind of force you're going to duplicate. They knew that they were with Jesus. They saw the force of Jesus in those disciples, and they couldn't say anything because Jesus already whipped the Sanhedrin. He already whipped the Pharisees. He already whipped the Sadducees with just his word and his presence because, number one, he demonstrated with power. And they understood the power of Jesus. They could not gainsay it. They could not go ahead along trying to challenge their power. They tried to come another way. But guess what? It did not happen. God got his assignment. It may cost you certain things, but the way in life that God is the assignment out of you, and that is your reward. You are alive. You are designed to eat. You are designed to kill. You are designed to roar. But the life begins to pray that when you pray, you're going to roar in the spirit world. When you pray, there's a sound in the spirit world that comes from your body. There's a sound that comes from your lips. And then you begin to roar. The enemy begins to flee because guess what? Now you're hungry. Now you want to eat. Now you want to take your territory. Now you want to feed. Or what's before you? Because God is calling you to arise, kill, and eat. Slumber has put many of our saints to sleep. Who knows our witness? Let's turn to Joshua and close it. Let's turn to Joshua 1. Verse 1 through 9. We're going to pull out some points here. Sister Bonnie, could you read for me, please? You're designed to bring war in the spirit realm, to conquer in the spirit realm and in the natural. Jesus did not come on the earth realm just to fold his hand. He signed the sword. I would cause a mother to refuse her daughter. Cause a father to reject his son. Because at that particular time, if you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, people in your family would turn your back, would turn their back on them. Amen? Let's go to Joshua 1:1-9. I'm just paraphrasing because you want to close that, give me a footnote. We're going to skip around to Joshua 1:9, please.
1-9?
Yes, 1-9. We're going to skip around.
Now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spoke unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead now. Therefore, arise, go over this Jordan, thou dost, and all this people unto the land which I give to them, even the children of Israel.
Let me stop right there. Now listen, you can't hear God unless you minister to the man of God and be in a position of humility and humbleness. All of a sudden, God spoke to Joshua. There's a communication going on. He started creating a fellowship with Joshua. Joshua, like, what are we going to do? We've been mourning for Moses. And in the midst of the end of the morning, the Lord stepped to Joshua and said, listen, I got a sign.
Skip on down to verse 8.
This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein.
Now this is a me.
For,
let's go ahead. We're going to go back up to
for
five.
Then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success.
Whithersoever thou goest.
Nine.
Okay. Now I'm going to go back up to five, and I'll give you a pretext for that. He said, listen, he told me Simon after he spoke to him, introduced himself. He said, now Joshua, Moses is dead. I'm going to be with you as I was with Moses. However, you're going to complete the assignment. And he told him all that he had to fix. He told him in the beginning what he had to fix. And then he said in verse 5, there shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. I will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. 6, he said, be strong and of good courage, for unto this people shall thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swore unto their fathers to give them. And he said in 7, only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe and do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou may prosper wheresoever thou goest. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou may observe to do according to all that is written therein. For thou shalt make thy way prosperous, then thou shalt have good success. Now here are the keys that God began to speak to Joshua. In Joshua 5 through 6, he said, no man shall stand before thee. As long as you're before my presence, no man can stand before you. As long as you meditate and practice my presence, my person, you have good success. And he said in verse 8, this is the key that he told me. In verse 8, the Lord said something to Joshua. The Lord says to Joshua. Verse 12, Joshua spake to the Lord. There's communication going on between the two. We read on now 1 through 9 in verse 12. There's communication between the two. Because of the time, I'm just skipping through this. There is communication between Joshua and God. When you practice, which is the mother, this is what mother means. Look at me. To meditate means to mother. This is what mother is. I'm going to show what mother is. To other words, distinctly, or in a low tone. To other words, distinctly, or in a low tone. The Lord told Joshua, read this word aloud, for life and death is in the tongue. I want you to mutter daily about me in this word of the Lord, so that we bring life to this children, the life to this nation. He had to mutter the words. He was speaking life over the children of Israel. He was muttering the words. Every day he had to mutter, day and night, read the word, read the word. Then the mutter also means to growl. When you growl, it's like a lion. When a lion chewed me, he growled. No. He growled. He's eating the meat that's muttering. So that means that Joshua is taking care of the meat of the master. Are you following here? He had a big assignment. And he was scared. He said, no, be of good courage. Now, when you practice your presence with God, then guess what? There are some things you can do in the midst of the assignment. In verse 14, let's turn to verse 13 and 14. Let's read 13 and 14. My closing.
Remember the words which Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded you, saying, the Lord your God hath given you rest and hath given you this land, your wives, your little ones, and your cattle shall remain in the land which Moses gave you on this side Jordan. But ye shall pass through before your brethren on all the mighty men of valor and help them.
Amen. The mighty men of valor will help them. And then we go forth during the wartime, they fight each other. They whooping everybody. They going through whooping everybody.
They're fleeing before them. The enemy is fleeing before Joshua. The wicked men are fleeing before Joshua even get there. They heard of what their God is doing. They heard the great exploit of God. They said, I don't want to be a part of that exploit. So they began to run. And Joshua and the nation of Israel began to pursue them and kill them. And then all of a sudden the sun began to go down. Now Joshua said, Lord, you're giving me this day, this hour, what I need from you. And the Lord said, speak it. And he said, I want the sun to stay still and the moon to stay in its place. And the Lord hearkened unto the voice of man. I'm reading from Joshua 10, verse 13 and 14. There is a communication that you have with God. When you spend time in his presence, when you have authority, you can say unto this particular creation, you hold right there. You can say to this particular disease, I bind you right now by the blood of Jesus. I command you, loose it, Lord. That spirit will have to go. Amen. This message was about to shock you. This message will give you insight of what kind of force you can have when you meditate on him. You can speak to yourself and say, miracle power is flowing in my body, healing power is flowing in my body. And when you spend time in this presence, you know for surety that miracle power is flowing in your body. You know for surety that healing power is flowing to your body. You can speak over yourself and not second guess what you're saying out of your mouth, because your mouth is used to saying the right things. Your mouth is used to saying the things what God is saying. You and God is in agreement, and you can cause heaven and earth to move. You can cause the unseen to scatter. You can cause things to draw unto you. You can cause you to go to things where they need to be, or you can meet in the middle. But if you don't practice his presence, if you don't do the necessary assignments with him, then where is your force? It brings you back to the title. What does your boldness look like? Stand to your feet. I know this word is kind of hard to digest, but nonetheless, I had to give it to you. Your boldness has a look. Everyone, look to your neighbor and say,
My boldness
has a look.
And with my boldness,
it has a witness.
It has a witness.
You ask your neighbor, where is your witness? If you can't answer that, then you need to get back into his presence. Just lift your hands. Father, I thank you for the word. I thank you for this boldness. That during this time, Father, that you've given us our testimonies. Our testimonies of your miracle working power in our lives. With me, Lord God, you've given me silver in my mouth, a form of process. With others, Father, you've given them children when they said they couldn't have any children. With other fathers, you healed their bodies when the doctor said, go one way, you took them another way to heal their bodies. That boldness in you will produce a witness. And Father, I ask you right now in the mighty name of Jesus, let them dust off their weakness and let them put a proper feeling for their boldness, that they may go forth in the land and harvest you. In Jesus' name. Let's clap my hands right now. Amen.